This is Jim Fusco.
This is
the following broadcast over the National Broadcasting Company in a coast-to-coast network is being made on June 4th, 1947. The story is based on the Snook Hicks murder case of 1929. These recordings will be made during the actual broadcast over WLW Cincinnati.
What's the matter?
Hey, did I say there was nobody around?
Yeah.
I was wrong. Look, there, lying in the grass. She's dead.
The Big Story. Another in a thrilling series based on true experiences of newspaper reporters. Tonight, to James E. Fusco of the Columbus Citizen goes the Pall Mall Award for The Big Story. Now the exciting and authentic story of the 13th Key.
By the time you, James Fusco, reporter for the Columbus Citizen, reached the rifle range at McKinley Avenue and Fisher Road, the crowd of police cars has drawn a cluster of curious citizenry. You push through their morbid mutterings, and your face, familiar to the law, is your own trespass. The coroner is at his work, kneeling.
Any identification, coroner?
Not yet, Jimmy. Take a look for yourself. Maybe you know her.
Nobody I know.
She's pretty.
Was, you mean?
Was. What caused the cut in her throat?
Knife. Take a closer look.
Do I have to?
Look, Jimmy, I'm giving you a clue free for nothing.
Okay. What am I supposed to notice?
That's not just any cut. It's careful. Surgical.
Thanks for the tip.
Okay, boys, take her away.
All through, Carla.
That's all for now, anyway.
Good afternoon, Mr. Drayle. How's the detective business?
Hiya, Jimmy. Well, plenty of it today. What brings you here?
Oh, I turn up at the best murders. Got any tips for me?
Not now. We've just... Hey, where are you going?
Nowhere. I just noticed something in the grass here. The sun was hitting it.
Uh-huh. Find something?
Yeah. It must have been lying under the girl's body.
It wouldn't by any chance be a key.
What made you ask that? It's a key ring.
Well, it must go with bees. I found them scattered all around.
Keys, huh?
Yep, an even dozen.
Oh. I wonder where the 13th is.
How do you know they were 13?
Hey, don't start suspecting me, Steve. All I did was figure.
Well, let me in on this figuring.
Elementary, my dear Watson. I found the key ring. You found 12 keys. Put 12 and 1 together, and the conclusion is somebody took those keys off the ring to get at another key.
Yeah, that makes sense. Sure. 13 keys. But who took the key?
I know.
Who?
The murderer.
First stop is the nearest telephone. You give rewrite enough to make the first edition, whose 1 p.m. deadline you're riding. Your next stop is the mortuary. There you find Bill Dawson from your own paper, and automatically you compare notes.
You got the angle on the cut in her throat?
Has this had been done by a doctor?
Yes. And the key scattered around?
Yeah, that I got. Did you know the police had sent for the folks whose daughter's been missing, the Bellinis?
No, I didn't know that.
Well, they're coming over the...
Come in now, boys. Laid out.
Okay, Andrew.
Here she is.
Bill.
Yeah.
Look.
Hmm?
Something I didn't notice at the rifle range.
What's that?
Her hands.
Huh?
Look at those long fingernails. The perfect manicure.
So?
So she couldn't be the Bellini girl. The Bellini girl worked in a laundry. This girl never worked with her hands.
You leave Bill Dawson at the morgue to wait for a possible identification. You go back to the Citizen office to write the roundup story. You're about 5 paragraphs down when the phone starts jumping.
Yeah?
Joe, this is Dawson. I got a present for you.
Let her rip.
The dead girl was just identified. She's Ellen Marion with an O, Johnson. That's S-T-O-N.
Nice going. Who is she?
You're going to love this. She was a second-year med student at Ohio State. She was 25.
Folks identify her?
Nope. They live down south. She was identified by two roommates who'd missed her for 2 days. Their names are Lenore Graham and Frances Eaton. And if you hotfoot right over to apartment 2B above the millinery shop on Green Street, you'll catch them coming home.
But the question is, will they talk?
No, I will not answer any questions.
Frances, please.
You have some nerve coming here, Mr. Fusco. Lying in wait for us at the door of our own apartment, invading our privacy. Why don't you behave like a gentleman, even if you're not one, and scumbag back your filthy paper?
Please, Frances. She's awfully upset, Mr. Fusco, and so am I.
Miss Graham, please realize I'm only doing my job.
I know.
Your job?
Yes, Miss Eaton. It's my job to ask questions, to find out everything I can about your roommate.
Filthy, morbid curiosity.
You don't have to insult him, Fran. He's just doing his job.
His job! His job! Why don't you just go away and leave us alone?
Because I'm a reporter. And believe me, I don't enjoy troubling you at a time like this any more than you like being troubled.
I don't think Mr. Fusco would do anything wrong.
All I want, Miss Graham, is a little information on your roommate, a picture if you have one, anything you can tell me about her folks.
You won't get anything out of me.
Miss Eaton, you make me say something I don't like to say.
Mr. Fusco, she doesn't mean anything. She's just terribly upset. We're both upset. Please, maybe if you come back tomorrow.
There's no tomorrow in the newspaper business, Miss Graham. And Miss Eaton, I have this to say. I can go back to my office.
Why don't you then? Why do I?
I can go back and write that you were too upset to talk about your friend.
But if you'd only come back later.
Or I can write you refuse to reveal anything about her. They both mean the same thing, but they sound awfully different.
You wouldn't do a thing like that.
Believe me, I'm not digging for dirt in a girl's tragedy. I'm trying to find a line to a murderer. If you'll only tell me one thing.
Nothing, nothing.
Just one thing. I think this is a love murder. And if you'll just tell me the names of the men she went out with.
She wasn't that kind of a girl. Lenore sent me away.
Somebody maybe you didn't know about. Somebody she might have been seeing secretly. Somebody who wrote her love letters. Letters she might have left in her room. If you'll just let me take a look around.
Okay, sister. Have it your way.
What? Mr. Fusco, you asked if Ellen Johnston had a boyfriend. Well, she did. You've got to find Louis Jack.
Why? Did they have a quarrel?
I can't tell you anything more. Just his name, Louis Jack.
Wait. What does he do? Is he a doctor?
Why, no. But he is a veterinary.
We'll be back in just a moment with tonight's big story. Now, we return you to your narrator, Barry Kroger, and the big story.
Arrests you don't make with a press badge. So you turn the name of the murdered girl's boyfriend over to the law. They pick up Louis Jack fast, and you get to sit in on the quizzing.
When was the last time you saw Miss Johnston, Louis?
Well, I had to go upstate last week to a veterinarian's field demonstration. Anthrax injections and anti-blackleg serums. That was last week around Friday.
The girl. When did you see the girl?
I'm trying to tell you. The demonstration was Friday, and I was supposed to get back that night. Only, well, you know how those things are. I always say the best laid plans of mice and men.
Look, Louis, I asked you a straight question. When did you see her last?
The day after I came back from the convention. Sunday. We went riding. I wanted to go to the movies because I'd had a very studious time, and I thought the movies would be fun, but she wanted to go riding.
So you quarreled?
Oh, no. No, just a lover's spat. You know how it is. You fussed about little things.
You were lovers?
Well, you know, sort of, kind of. We went out a lot together, you know.
I don't know. I'm trying to find out.
Why are you asking me all these questions? After all, I only went out with a girl. Gosh, you can't blame a fella for going out with a girl.
Lewis.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to start all over again, right at the beginning. And, Lewis, make the answers short.
Gosh, try. But if... Could I ask a question first?
No, he's asking the questions. What is it?
Could I have a drink of water?
Holy cat! Sit there. Jimmy.
What?
What do you think? Could anybody be that dumb, or is he playing dopey?
I don't know, but I've got an idea.
Want to take a crack at questioning? Think you can break him?
No, no. But why don't you take him to the morgue and make him look at her now?
Detective and Lewis, you get to the morgue just in time to find a stern-looking woman having an argument with the attendant.
Why can't I go in? Why can't I go in and see her?
Are you any kidding?
I told you no.
Are you the law?
Are you crazy? I told you I was her landlady.
You can't go in. You ought to be ashamed. What are you trying to do? Collect back rent? Go on home, lady.
What's the trouble here, Andrew?
She wants to go look at the girl. Says she's her landlady.
What do you want to see her for?
Because I knew her and her husband both.
Her husband? You mean she lived with those two girls and her husband?
Who are you to be asking me questions?
Never mind him. Answer me. What's this about a husband?
And what about the two girls?
What two girls?
Lenore and Frances, the ones who lived with her upstairs over the millinery store.
Over the millinery? Look, you're crazy. I run a boarding house over on South Wilton Street. She never lived with no two girls. She lived with her husband.
Would you know him?
I sure would.
Lewis, come here.
Yeah? What do you want?
All right, lady. Did you ever see this man before?
Never in my life.
Lewis, did you ever see this woman before?
No, never. Why, did she kill Miss Johnston?
Shut up! Did either of you ever see her?
She's still beautiful.
You both knew her?
Yeah, that's her.
That's the girl who lived at your place as a married woman?
Yeah, that's her.
And that's the girl you went out with as a single girl?
Uh-huh.
Well, one of you is lying. Or she was.
Ma'am, what name did she give when she boarded with you?
That's right. What name did she give?
Why, their married name, of course. Mr. and Mrs. Ed Smith.
Ed Smith. What did he do?
Why, he never did say, but their comings and goings were awful odd. I know she studied over to the hospital, and I kind of figured the way he always carried a bag.
Yeah,
you know,
go on.
Well, I just naturally figured he was a doctor.
It fit so well, the police let the bumbling boyfriend free with a warning to stay in town. And they start looking for Dr. Ed Smith. The landlady gives one clue to the identity of this obviously phony-named gentleman. He drove a blue coupe, and this you add to your list of clues. You enumerate them, evaluate them, using Dawson as your foil.
Okay, Bill, here's how it shapes up now.
Hmm?
We know she was leading a double life. That puts the finger on it as a love murder. Item one, he was a doctor.
Check.
Item two, he has the missing key.
Check.
Item three, he drives a blue coupe.
Uh-huh.
And item four, he must have been familiar with a rifle range.
Why?
Well, it's not an ordinary place to go with a girl. He must have been attracted to it somehow. And item five...
Yeah.
Item five, the landlady may be the key to the 13th key. Bill, I tell you what. I'm going to call on that landlady. Why don't you wait here and start checking the sports department clips?
What for?
Rifle matches, pistol matches, shooting meets. Look for contestants who are doctors. Or even nicknamed Doc. This Dr. Smith, ma'am, when did you see him last?
Why, the day they found her body.
How'd that happen?
He come to turn in the key.
What key?
The key to their apartment.
The 13th key.
How's that?
Nothing. At about what time did he turn in the key?
Oh, round about the middle of the afternoon.
Did he say anything?
Yep. He said, here you are, ma'am. We won't be needing it anymore.
Why did he say that?
Because he said they was leaving town. He said they were... Say!
Hmm?
Do you think he done it?
What do you think?
Tip for one thing. All we have to do is find a middle-aged doctor who drives a blue coupe and who frequents or is familiar with the rifle range. Now, what do you know?
Only what I found in the clips.
Anything?
Well, just this. The former pistol champion of the United States competed in a match at the range the day before the body was found. His name is Lance Crackett. He lives here in Columbus. Known in pistol and rifle circles as Doc.
Why?
Because he's a doctor.
That must be him mowing the lawn.
Yeah. Dr. Crackett.
Yes?
I'm Steve Drayle, Columbus Police. This is Jim Fusco from the Citizen. Will you come with us, Doctor?
What for?
Questioning.
About what?
The murder of Miss Johnston. Did you know her?
Yes.
Better come along, Doctor.
Well, let me shave and tell my wife. Then I'll drive over.
I think you'd better come with us, Doctor. But you can tell your wife.
Hey, I'll be right out.
You certainly will. Because I'm coming in with you. Wait here, Jimmy.
It's funny how things get quiet and moody when they're hottest. This is the point you've been aiming at ever since you looked at the body with the carefully cut throat. And now, all you can do is think how nice a day it is. You chew a little piece of grass and study the green stains on the inside wheel of the lawnmower. Yes. Green stained wheel. It gives you an idea. You walk over to the garage attached to the doctor's house. You peer inside. You find a switch. There's a car there. It is a blue coupe. There is a stain on the seat. A red stain. You make a deal with the detective in return for the help you can give him. Yours is an afternoon paper, and if Drayle doesn't bring in the doctor right away, if he holds the story a little longer, it will be too late for the morning opposition. He agrees to that, and you borrow the doctor's car key. You make one stop, and then you make a phone call.
Citizen.
Bill Dawson?
Yeah.
Jimmy Fusco.
Oh.
Bill, I think we've got the killer. I'll dictate the whole story to you, but first let me set something with you.
Go ahead.
The doctor's car was just left at a lab to have a stain analyzed. I have an idea he'll deny it's blood. I want to confront him with the truth, if it is blood. So I'll dictate the story now. Go ahead and run it.
Okay.
And I'll call you back with the rest of the dope when the report's coming in. Now, if anybody wants me, I'll be looking up the landlady first, and then I'll be at police headquarters.
Check.
All right, ready? Here goes. Police today arrested Dr. Lance Crackett, physician and former pistol champion of the United States, for questioning in connection with the murder of Miss Cummings.
Jim, it's been 3 hours since we ran that story on Crackett's arrest. The desk is going crazy. We've been queried by the press services and everybody.
I know.
And what's more, some of the papers are carrying a denial of our expert. Jim, have you got the paper in our box? Have you gone crazy?
I don't think so.
Then where's the dick and the doctor?
Frankly?
Come on.
I don't know.
Finally, the detective escorts the doctor in the back way to the chief's office. He winks at you, the detective, that is, and finds time to whisper...
Did I do okay, Jimmy? Did I keep him out long enough?
Did you? You almost lost us both our jobs.
They sit the doctor down. They ask him quiet, careful questions. Did he know the girl? Did he kill her? No.
Did he date her? Yes. Was he a lover? No. Back and forth. Very quiet questioning, very calm answering. His case is airtight until you ask to have it held up a moment. Then you call in the landlady and ask,
Mrs. Hammett, is this the man who boarded with Miss Johnston?
Yes.
Is he the one who returned the key?
Yes.
Thank you. All right, Doctor, you might as well tell us how it happened.
I will.
You killed her?
No. But I did have a date with her that night. She threatened to blackmail my wife and me if I didn't give her money.
So you killed her?
No. I remonstrated with her and said I'd raise the money. But she said she had to have it now.
So you killed her?
No, I argued and pleaded and promised and... Then I threw her out of the car and drove away.
After killing her?
No. Somebody else must have done that after I left.
Is that your story?
That is the truth.
Doctor, why did you return the key?
Because I wanted to end the whole business. I didn't want to use that apartment anymore.
There are only two things wrong with that explanation, Doctor. One is you couldn't have got that key ring from her without using force.
But I didn't get the key ring.
And the other is the time you returned the key. What time did you turn it in?
At 2:00 in the afternoon.
The day after your call, the day her body was found?
That's right.
How'd you know she was dead?
I read it in the paper.
Are you sure?
Positive. I read it in the early edition.
You're sure of that?
Certainly.
Doctor, here's a clipping of my first story, the one from the early edition. Read it.
All right. Police were called Friday afternoon to the rifle range in Fisher Road near McKinley Avenue where...
Go on.
Where the unidentified body of a woman was found. Coroner Murphy was called. That's all.
You're right. That's all. Doctor, how did you know the body was that of your girlfriend when the paper carried no name? That story appeared on the street at 1:30. You returned the key at 2:00. The extra identifying the body was not out until 5:00. How did you know the body was Miss Johnston?
I don't know.
You told the landlady you wouldn't be needing the key anymore. How did you know that, Doctor? How did you know? I'll tell you how. Because you were the only one who knew that early that she was dead.
You can't prove that.
Steve Drail speaking. Yeah. Well, thank you very much. That was it, Jim. The news we've been waiting for.
Good. What did you just say, Doctor? We can't prove you did it?
No, you can't prove it.
We can help. Get me Bill Dawson at the Citizens. Just listen in on my conversation with my paper, Dr. Crackett. Bill, about that laboratory test of the stain in the car. We just got the report. I can tell you in one word. Blood.
That does it. That's it. You've helped to apprehend a murderer. And you've got your big story.
In just a moment, we'll read you a telegram from James Fusco. Now, here's that telegram sent by James Fusco of the Columbus Citizen.
Thank you for dramatizing my big story. Doctor was found guilty of murder in the first degree. Statements I took at killer's confession were introduced as evidence in trial. I received number one ticket to execution. Again, many thanks for a Pell-Mell award.
Thank you, Mr. Fusco. The makers of Pall Famous Cigarettes are proud to have named you winner of the Pall $500 Award for notable service in the field of journalism.
Listen again next week, same time, same station, when Pall Famous Cigarettes will present another big story.